Sometimes we need to protect what is called the system status. That means counters, variables, and all the information our project needs and cannot be lost over a power failure. There are many ways to perform this protection, depending on the architecture of your project and the system you are controlling with your project. In this video, we will see how to use a PVD device. The power voltage detector, or PVD, is a component of a PWD device available on every STM32 microcontrollers. It monitors the power source, alerting in case of a power loss. We'll use it here to save the system information in case of a power failure. Let's go using the PVD device. This is the system we are using in this test. It is based on a black pill board made by WIAC Studios, having an STM32F411. I like WIAC Studios board because they provide full information on them, helping in using them in a project. We have also an SPI TFT display showing a value of a counter increased every second. We will see how to save a counter value when the STM32 detects a power failure via the PVD device. That is an I2C EEPROM module where we will write a counter value in the time period since when the PVT detects the power failure and before the voltage falls to zero. Finally, there is a step-down adapter converting a 12 volts input in a 3.3 voltage powering the system. We will see that capacitors and inductances of a step-down converter can provide enough power when the power fails to let the I2C EEPROM receive and store the counter value. Let's start designing the project. I'm using here the STM32CubeID and create a new project. Here I select the STM32F411, which is a microcontroller we are using here, and giving a name to the project, click Finish to generate it. First of all, I'll go enabling the external clock signal, having the board at 25 MHz quartz. Here I enable the clock at 100 MHz, which is the maximum speed of the microcontroller. Then I will enable the serial wire debug to program and debug the board. Now I enable the SPI1, which pins are connected to the display. I set it as an ALF to Plex Master, and I enable also the NSS in output mode. I'm using here a library I made managing the SPI display based on the ST7735. I will not go here into the details about the display or my library, as we are using it just to monitor how is going the counter value. I prepare a separate video about the display, the library, and the performance. I set SPI speed to 25 MHz. And then I enable 3 more pins in output mode, as I need them to drive the display. I set here the pin names as requested by my library. The backlight LED, the data command pin, the reset, the chip select run by NSS, and the two SPI pins, the clock and the MOSI pin. Finally, I'm enabling the I2C1 port for the EEPROM. I let it to the 100 kHz default speed. For the EEPROM also, I'm going to use my own library. And even for the EEPROM library, I go just using it without entering in details. You'll find more info in a dedicated video. Anyway, in this case, library doesn't need assigning defined pin names, but I set them for the sake of clarity. The system is set for our first test, so I'm going to save the configuration and generate the C files. Now I will add the display library. I'm using a version with the STM fonts, copying the .c files in the source directory and the .h files in the include directory. Now I'm opening the main.h file, adding the include command for the .h files of the library. Before to proceed, I have to set up some parameters in the display.h files. The default values are referring to the SPI1, so I let them unchanged. Then I go adding the EEPROM library in the same way. Here also I have to check configuration defined in the .h file, and here you must check not just the I2C port used, but also the EEPROM I2C address and the type of EEPROM in terms of total size and its page size. Again, please refer to the dedicated video for details. Now I'm assigning a name to the memory address I will use to store the counter. So, the libraries are set. Let's try to compile to see if we forgot something, then go to set the main function. That's the definition of a global variable representing the counter that will be increased and shown over the display. In the main loop, I define a string called scounter and convert the counter value to the string via sprintf, because the display library will send just string over the SPI toward the display. After the conversion, I'm increasing the counter to the next value. Now I send the string to the display using a function that centers the string into a graphic area of the display. Parameters of the function are the top left and bottom right coordinates of the area, the pointer to the string, the font used and the size, then color of the text and background. It will be white over a dark, dark blue. Then I'll put a 1 second delay. Ok, the loop is converting the counter to a string. Increase the counter, send the string to the display, wait for a second and restart converting the new counter value to the string. Now, before writing over the display, it needs to be initialized. Indicating the printing orientation. Then I clear the display and finally turn on the display backlight. That's all. Program should be working. Let's try to compile and run the program over the STM32. Okay, it is receiving the program now. And run. Counter start from zero and increase every second. Now, powering off the system and back to on will restart the counter from zero. But that's the case. Suppose we can't lose the counter value. We need to store it over the EEPROM. Supposing you won't write into the EEPROM every time the counter change, because, well, that's not the case here, but it can easily burn out the EEPROM for the number of writing cycles it can accept. We could keep the counter value into RAM, using the PVD feature to detect the power is going off and writing into EEPROM just one time before the power failure. This is the reference manual of the STM32F411. Here we go to the power controller, to the power supply supervisor, and inside that to the PVD description. Here we can see that this device monitors the power supply VDD, comparing it to a programmable threshold through the PLS field. And looking for it, we can see it can have 8 different values, setting the threshold from 2.2 to 2.9 volts. Back to the PVD description, we can see that when VDD drops below the threshold or rises above it, PVD can generate an interrupt. That's for the STM32F411. Other microcontrollers of the STM32 family can have enhanced features for more complex needs. This is a Nucleo 32 based on the STM32G4. As we can see in its reference manual, it has a PVD working more or less like the F41. But if we go to see the threshold definition, we will see that we can use an input pin to monitor. Moreover, G4 has two independent comparators monitoring VDDA over a predefined threshold and generating independent interrupts. But back to F411, let us see its HAL user manual. Going to PWR driver, we can see it makes available a config PVD function, an enable PVD, and a disable PVD. Then we have also a PVD callback related to the PVD interrupt. Config PVD needs a parameter as a pointer to a structure containing the configuration asked for the PVD, while enable PVD has no parameters. The structure to be passed to config PVD is described at chapter beginning and has two data fields, PVD level and mode. PVD level defines the threshold and can assume the values from 0 to 7 as we have seen in the reference manual. PVD mode can assume values defining when the interrupt has to be generated, on the rising edge, falling, or both edges. Now we should have enough information to go back to our project and handle PVD. As a first step, I create two new files setting a PVD library I can use also in other projects. So I create a new source file, naming it pvd.c, and a new header file named pvd.h. Then I will add pvd.h to the included files in main.h. While in the .c file, I will include the main.h in order to get the microcontroller libraries defined by the CubeMX. Now, in pvd.c, I will create a new function, setting the initial configuration of pvd. I need a variable to store the configuration, and I get the type from the HAL manual, as same as the variable name, just for the sake of clarity. Now, config pvd has two fields setting, the voltage level, which I will set to the highest 2.9 volts in order to detect the power failure as soon as possible, and the pvd mode that I set to the rising and falling edge interrupt, getting any alarm on the power source. Now the configuration is set, and I can call the config pvd passing the variable. And then calling enable pvd. So init pvd is complete, and I can go to the main.c, and before entering to the main loop, I will add a call to init pvd function. Now I have to set the callback function. Here I will add the command to write into the EEPROM. I'm using a simple function available in my library, which gets as parameters the memory address to start writing a string containing data and the number of bytes to write. Now, the global variable counter is a byte. I just create a small text and put the counter value in its first character and declaring counter x extern. That should be enough, but as I don't know how move VDD while the system is powering off, there is a possibility to multiple interrupt calls. So I set a flag, calling it done, which led me writing into EEPROM just one time. Done is static, and initially set to 0. Then I test it, and just if it is 0, I will write the EEPROM, and then I set it to 1. So, in case of multiple interrupt calls, callback will write into EEPROM only the first time. OK, pvd is now set, and the same is for the callback function. I have just to add the two functions to the header file. So, on the system wake up, I read the EEPROM, getting the value stored into, and setting the initial value of counter. The EEPROM reading function in my library gets a whole EEPROM page, so I have to properly set a string to store it.
when I'll use just the first byte, setting the initial value of counter. Okay, software is set. We need just to enable PVD interrupt using QBMX. Open QBMX, go to System Core, NVIC, enable PVD interrupt, and save the configuration. Now we can compile the program and run it over the microcontroller. Now Black Pill is receiving the program through the ST-Link. And start. Now, powering off the system, PVD detects it and writes the counter value into EEPROM. Powering back on, Black Pill reads EEPROM and sets the counter, restoring the value before the power off. Let's do some final considerations. This is the datasheet of EEPROM I'm using, the 256 kilobit. On the first page we see the main information. I was running I2C at 100 kHz, but EEPROM is compatible with Fast Mode and Fast Mode Plus I2C, running up to 1 MHz. Memory is organized in pages of 64 bytes, and write cycle needs 5 milliseconds. So, writing up to 64 bytes, we need less than 1 millisecond for the I2C data transfer and 5 milliseconds for the memory writing. Memory that can operate until voltage is as low as 1.7 volts. Now, knowing the current in the system, you can easily define the size of the capacitor you need. In this case, capacitor and inductance in the step-down converter are more than enough. In case you need to save more than 64 bytes of data, it is better to move to other memory sites. This is a 512 kilobit EEPROM. As you can see, it has the same characteristics in terms of I2C speed and writing time, but has a 128 bytes page length, allowing a double-sided writing space available in the 5 milliseconds limit. That's all. I hope you enjoyed this video. See you in the next one.